Good morning. Welcome to Grace United Methodist Church. We are glad that you are here on this beautiful Sunday morning. We welcome you here. Hope that you have felt welcome coming into this place to gather and to worship. As we remind ourselves each and every week, a life connected to God and a life connected to one another is the most meaningful life there is. And that is why we are here, to connect with God, to connect with one another, so that our lives can be more of what God is calling them to be. I also hope you received an order of worship on your way in this morning. A few things I would like to point out to you in way of reminder. I do ask that you read all the announcements so that you know what's going on, but a few things that I will point out to you. You heard, hopefully last Sunday if you were here, you heard that In His Steps was kicking off. In His Steps is a ministry opportunity here for you at Grace to sign up to be in ministry together in a variety of ways. The forms to sign up are out those doors to the table on the left in a box, in a plastic box that says In His Steps. Some are labeled with names and some are just not. You can grab one if you see your name on one, or you can just grab a form and fill it out. A reminder, you do not have to be a member to serve. Membership is not required. So we invite all people to serve, and as you will hear maybe a little bit later in today's service, giving and serving are two of the most unnatural things for us humans to do. And oddly enough, giving and serving are also two of the biggest false gods, money and self. And so we have to be reminded to serve and reminded to give, and that has to happen frequently for us. So just keep that in mind, that you're all gifted to serve, and we have a place for you to serve here at Grace. Also a reminder, Charge Conference is coming up on Thursday, October the 10th, 6:30. Our district superintendent will be here with us, centering our minds with a worship thought and then going through the business of the Church of Charge Conference. If you have not already purchased your United Methodist Men's Hash tickets, Hash Sale is coming up Saturday, October the 12th. You can get your tickets from Frank Colbreth. Also a reminder, Rise Against Hunger, happening Sunday, October the 13th from 2 to 4 in the Abbeville Civic Center. We'll be packing boxes with food to be shipped off for those who are hungry. You can see places to sign up, or if you have not already signed up online, you can contact MJ Biggerstaff there by an email to let her know that you will be participating. One final thing, hopefully you saw a table also out front this morning with a box and some food items and a list, and you're thinking, what in the world is that? Well, there's information about Build a Box, food box for families in need for Thanksgiving. Miss Rachel Blackburn, if you would take a couple of minutes. I think it is.
Hey, am I on?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, so I just want to take just a short time. I have MJ's few minutes, and we want to talk about building a box. It's a part about service, and it's also a part about food. We have many people in our community that are not as blessed maybe as we are. So we're asking that you help us build a box. You can build a box on your own. Many families are taking a box, and they're building a box full of these goods. We have a list. You'll find the list out on the table. So also, this is another Build-A-Box. This is about the size that it'll take if you want to build one. It may take two of these, but anyway, it won't take a lot of your money. We ask that all items be in date, and we ask that all items just be on the list. And if you think of a few other things you want to add to it, you can do that. We also have a little box. Guess what this is for? Money. Or we would ask also, if you know a family that might need a box, if you just drop their name in this box too. I think that's about all we have. We plan to do this in October, 31 items, around the 1st of November for Thanksgiving. We'd like to bless some people with a box of goodies, some extras for their house and for their family. We're going to do it again in December too, so y'all get ready. Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel. And thank you for reminding us again, this is giving, serving. This is the ministry of the church. This is why we exist, church. Bless you. Jesus created the church so that we would be a light and love for others. That's why we exist. And we have opportunities to do that every week, not just on Sunday, but every day of every week. So let's be reminded of those things. I'd invite you to stand with me this morning as we affirm our faith. These words that have been passed down from generation to generation, called the Apostles' Creed, these words reminding us the basics and the essentials of the Christian faith. Let us join together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
And let us continue standing as we continue our worship in song this morning.
Bravest preacher that's ever been in Grace Church. Let two Manleys get up with a microphone on the same day. God bless him. Great to be here. Great to be among my Christian brothers and sisters. Such a blessing. Such a blessing. Let's pray. Father God, we come to you on this day that you have made. We praise you in it. We are here, Lord, to praise your holy name, to raise your name above all names, to lift your word for the understanding of your people, to learn to serve you. Father, we ask you to touch Jason, to lead him as he speaks to us, that the words that he has come straight from the Holy Spirit to us. He's a brave warrior of the word, Lord. Give him the word that we need. Help us to understand it and to make it move. Now hear our prayer, Lord, as we pray together the prayer of the disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
While you're up, take a moment and greet those around you and welcome them to Grace.
Hey, y'all.
She says, "Is that why you were humming that when we were in the airport?" I said, "Yeah, plus I don't like flying." So I'm Lord, take my hand. Let's continue worshiping God with God's tithe and our offering. As we have a chance to give back to God, what is God's? God's tithe. They go beyond the giving of a tithe and to give an offering. And again, we remind ourselves of things every week. You may get tired of hearing me say the same old thing. But it's good to be reminded why we give. We give not because God needs it. We give because we need to give. Our giving reminds us of the one who provides for us everything that we need. And our giving reminds us that it is in God we put our faith and trust. It is not in money or stuff. Because money or stuff cannot save you. Only God will be with you all the way. So that's why we give. Then secondly, we give because it enables the church to do what the church has been called to do, to be in mission and ministry to the world. So let us pray together. God, you are a good God, and you are a God who takes our hand every day, even though at times we may not realize it, we may not even feel it. But God, the invitation from you to us is there. Hey, let me take your hand and let me lead you. Jesus, that's really what it is about following you, saying, "Hey, Jesus, let me take a hold of your hand and follow you." And my life's going to be ups and downs, and it's going to be mess ups, and sometimes everything goes right. But at the end of the day, I just want to follow you. God, I pray that as we intently want to follow more after you, God, that we will take seriously the invitation to give. And we will be reminded that you are a faithful God that always provides for us each and everything that we need. And so, God, we ask by the power of your Holy Spirit that you would bless and multiply the giving and the receiving in this place today. And God, that you would bless and multiply it, not so we could build up a big bank account. God, we pray you would bless and multiply it so that we could send out mission and ministry into this community and in this world. That's why we give, so that lives can be transformed. And so, God, one final thing we pray in advance is that your Holy Spirit will already be at work in the lives, the minds, and the hearts of those who will be impacted by the gospel of Jesus through us, your church, Grace United Methodist Church. In Christ's holy name we pray all these things. Amen.
Together as we present God's tithes and our offerings. You can be seated, and children can be dismissed for children's church.
Our scripture this morning comes from 1 Timothy 6, verses 9 and 10, the New Revised Standard Version. I pray we open our hearts to hear the word of God now. But those who want to be rich fall into temptation and are trapped by many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, and in their eagerness to be rich, some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pains. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be.
A commercial break, if you will, before we get into the sermon. Sometimes when people tell me something right before worship, I forget it. Like when Lee said, hey, don't forget to announce that the fifth quarter is this coming Friday after the home football game. So I forgot it during their announcements, but I remembered it during the offertory. So just want to let you know, fifth quarter this Friday evening after the football game here. At Grace, so just keep that in mind. Commercial break is over. Now to the sermon. Maybe you looked in the bulletin this morning and you looked at the sermon title and you saw, hopefully, giving it all up, and maybe you thought, wow, we're still in this sermon series. Yep, we got today and next week. But then maybe you looked at the other part of the title after giving it all up and you saw those three words, all or nothing. All or nothing. Years ago, that was kind of a motto or a mantra of mine that I just began to think about, and that kind of happens from time to time, usually around the first of the year. I'll just kind of get a motto or a mantra in my mind for what I want to be focused on for the upcoming year. And years ago, that was one of those mottos or mantras, all or nothing. And I began to think about all or nothing in terms of life, because to be all or nothing is to be completely committed. So in my life, how could I practice this idea, this motto, this mantra of all or nothing? When I was in a lot better shape than I am now, I also use that in my workouts. I'm going to give it all or nothing. I'm going to give it all I have. It became such a thing that I thought about over and over and over. I even had it engraved on a belt buckle years ago, which was kind of weird and redneck, I guess. But anyway, But I think about those three words, all or nothing. To be completely committed. And when I read the Gospels and I read when Jesus is talking to his disciples, when Jesus is talking to would-be followers of him, when Jesus is talking to wannabe disciples, Jesus is basically laying out for those who are following him or considering following him, Jesus is basically saying, when you follow me, it is an all or nothing thing. You know, he said it another way, that you can't put your hand to the plow and look back. You're either following me or you're not, Jesus says. And let us also be reminded that when Jesus invites people to follow him, he does not give them a list of rules, things you must do and must not do. Jesus basically says, you love God with all that you are and you love your neighbor as yourself. And he went on to say in John's gospel, the world will know you're my disciples. The world will know you're following me by how you attend church. No. The world will know you are my disciples. The world will know you are following me by how you love one another. And for Jesus, this idea of following and this idea of love and what your life looks like in following him, it's really an all or nothing mentality. Now, to say all or nothing does not mean that you're not going to mess up. To say all or nothing in following Jesus does not mean that you're not going to stumble along the way. To say all or nothing when it comes to following Jesus does not often give the always image of running after Jesus. Sometimes it's feebly crawling after Jesus. But to say all or nothing in terms of following Jesus is that Jesus, I'm committing my entire life to you. And I'm not going to always get it right, but I know there's going to be grace there, and I'm going to try my best to keep following you. See, 2 weeks ago, we began the sermon series entitled Giving It All Up. And we began this series for the intentional purpose of considering what it is to follow Jesus, what following Jesus really looks like in your everyday, day-to-day routines. What is it to follow Jesus? If you remember, a couple of weeks ago, when we began this series, we heard Jesus talk about to his disciples that if they were going to follow him, then he had to be the first priority, and they were to take up their cross daily and follow him. And we came to the takeaway, the conclusion of that sermon 2 weeks ago, that following Jesus will cost you everything. It will cost you your entire life, all or nothing. Last week, we were reminded that if we're following after Jesus, Jesus told this parable of how the shepherd left the 99 sheep for one, how the woman lost this one coin and she dug all around her house to find it, and when both were finally found, there was celebration, and it was a reminder for us, the church, that we too should have the same mentality, because around us, in our communities, in our homes, in our world in which we live, there are people who are hurting, there are people who are searching, and there are lost people around us daily, and it is up to us to go through the least, the last, and the lost. And when we do, just like Jesus, our reputation may be second-guessed. Like, why are they with those people? And so today we continue this series of giving it all up. And we're at a point in Luke's gospel that is significant to remember, because way back in chapter 9, in fact, chapter 9, verse 51, Luke lets the readers know what Jesus is doing. He says, Jesus set his face towards Jerusalem, which means for us to know that Jesus is going to Jerusalem. He knows when he gets there, he's going to be betrayed, he's going to be crucified, but then he will rise. And so that's important to remember, because after chapter 9, verse 51, every verse, every story, and every idea in Luke's gospel is setting up the reader and is setting up the hearers, not only for what's going to happen in Jerusalem, but what your life is going to be like after Jerusalem. And today what we're going to read in just a moment from chapter 16, this idea of giving it all up, it even means your money. No, Jason, not a sermon on money and giving. See, most of us, when we get to the part about money and possessions, we have the tendency to think, okay, Jesus, you've talked about carrying my cross daily. You've talked about going to the least, the last, and the lost, and that how that may could mess up my reputation. But now you done gone to meddling. You're starting to talk about money and possessions. I mean, what else do you want, Jesus? See, when folks come to church, really, honestly, and even pastors for the most part, the last thing we want to talk about is money. It just makes us feel kind of awkward. Makes me feel awkward to talk about it. Sometimes it makes us feel awkward to hear about it, because really, think about it. Your money and your pocketbook, you say, that's my business. That's my business. But the problem is, if you write notes, write this down, because it's something good to remember. The problem is, Jesus is always getting into our business. And if you want to follow after Jesus, he's going to always get in your business, because he wants to make you more like him. If he's not getting in your business, something might be wrong. See, Jesus knows better than any of us that there are not many things in this world that carry the temptation and the struggle like money and possessions. And maybe, just maybe, that's why Jesus talked more about money and possessions than he did anything else. And so our takeaway today is, we consider this giving it all up, this all or nothing attitude. Our takeaway today is very simple, something you've maybe heard along the way, but here it is. Followers of Jesus can only serve one master. It's all or nothing. You can only have one master. And as we think about money and possessions, there's always a positive and there's always a negative when it comes to thinking about material things, because there's always issues of poverty and there's always issues of wealth, and they're both very complex, and there's always anxiety about money, even if you don't have a lot or if you have a lot. There's always anxiety about money. But the words we're going to read today from Jesus remind us that followers of Jesus can only serve one master. So we're going to read a story from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 16, verses 1 through 13. And I'm going to be straight up honest with you, because that's the only way I know to be. This is a very difficult parable. This one takes a hot minute to walk through. So just hang with me, all right? Luke chapter 16, verses 1 through 13. You can follow along with me on the screen. Then Jesus said to the disciples, "There was a rich man who had a manager, and charges were brought to him that this man was squandering his property. So he summoned him and said to him, 'What is this that I hear about you? Give me an accounting of your management, because you cannot be my manager any longer.' Then the manager said to himself, 'What will I do? Now that my master has taken the position away from me, I'm not strong enough to dig, and I'm ashamed to beg. I have decided what to do, so that when I am dismissed as manager, people may welcome me into their homes.' So summoning his master's debtors one by one, he asked the first, 'How much do you owe my master?' He answered, 100 jugs of olive oil. He said to him, 'Take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 50. Then he asked another, 'And how much do you owe?' And he replied, 100 containers of wheat. He said to him, 'Take your bill and make it 80. Listen to this. And his master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. For the children of this age are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than are the children of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of dishonest wealth, so that when it is gone, they may welcome you into eternal homes. Whoever is faithful in a very little is faithful also in much, and whoever is dishonest in a very little is dishonest also in much. If then you have not been faithful with a dishonest wealth, who will entrust to you the true riches? And if you have not been faithful with what belongs to another, who will give you what is your own? No slave can serve two masters. For a slave will either hate the one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth." Told you that's a tough parable. The previous chapter, chapter 15, we touched on a couple of those stories last week. We talked about the lost sheep and the lost coin. The story that we did not touch on was the story of the prodigal son. And the whole point of those parables, and again, a parable is a simple story used to illustrate a moral or spiritual lesson. The whole point of those parables in chapter 15 was that what was lost had been found. And so we turn the page and you pick up right after that last parable of the prodigal son, and you begin in chapter 16, verse 1, and Luke begins, "Then Jesus said to the disciples." So Jesus goes from telling one parable to telling another, and this one is completely directed to the disciples. Because if you remember chapter 15, it was directed to primarily the Pharisees and the scribes. So Jesus now turns to the disciples and he begins another parable. And as I was thinking about all this, I began to think, how can you go from telling that parable to this parable? Because this parable will rack your brain. It's like the dishonest manager is being commended for being dishonest. And I began to think that maybe, just maybe losing self to the value of material things, you will find your true disciple life. See, Jesus went from talking about lost things to losing yourself to material things. That if you really want to truly find what it is to follow Jesus, consider money and possessions as great gifts, but they don't define your life. And it's really worth giving it all up, all or nothing, for the sake of following Jesus. Because followers of Jesus can only serve one master. And so let's get to the story. We read this story that Jesus, this parable that Jesus is telling his disciples, and he says there was this manager, and he was squandering the property of his master, of this rich man that he worked for. And this rich man, this master, gets word of it, and he says, "Hey, I know what you've been doing. I want my books back. I want my ledgers. I want to get what's really coming to me. I want to truly settle it. You're done." In verse 3, Luke records for us, and Jesus telling this parable, the manager, this honest manager, asked a question of himself. He said, "What will I do?" And if you're familiar with Luke's gospel, then you know throughout Luke's gospel that question is asked periodically, "What will I do?" And in fact, the last person to ask this question, "What will I do?" was in chapter 12, verse 17, with the parable of the rich fool, when he said, "What will I do? I will build bigger barns." And God said at the end of that, "You're a fool, because your life does not consist of stuff." So the dishonest manager asked himself that question, "What will I do?" He didn't know what to do. He said, "I'm not strong enough to dig, and I sure ain't going to beg because I'm not reaching that level." Then he said, "I know what I'll do." When he said, "I know what I'll do," what he basically was deciding to do is that I will take care of others today so that my tomorrow will be good. I will take care of others. I will help others now to ensure me a future. So he goes back in this story to all the folks who owe, and he says, "Here, this is what it says. This is how much you owe. Make it this." See, and in the story, what the dishonest manager was doing is he was out helping the poor and the needy, because the poor and the needy were the ones who had borrowed from his master. And this parable is called the parable of the dishonest manager. And this, honestly, this can be kind of an offensive parable, because we read it at first and we think, how could Jesus commend dishonesty? This does not sound like anything that Jesus would say. And Jesus, hear me out, Jesus is not commending dishonesty in this parable. Rather, what Jesus is doing is commending shrewdness. Really, what Jesus is doing in telling this parable and setting up this story is the manager in the story is a shrewd saint, if you will. And Jesus is calling his disciples to the same shrewdness. Now begin to think, what does this word shrewd mean? Here's what shrewd means. It means to have sharp powers of judgment, to have wisdom. I begin to think of shrewdness this way in light of this parable. You got a little street sense about you. Or maybe it's how Jesus told his disciples in another gospel, "I want you to be wise as serpents and harmless as doves." It's to be clever. It's to be alert. Or maybe to help us understand this word of shrewd and what it means and why Jesus would commend us as his followers to be shrewd, it's kind of like this. Have you ever known someone who can make a little bit of something go a long way? I see a few people grinning because they know they have, or they are those people. See, the manager is shrewd, and here's why he's shrewd, and this is what really gets us to the meat of this parable. The manager is shrewd because he treats the money and the stuff as if it has no essential or necessary value. Did you hear me? The manager is shrewd because he treats the money, the possessions, and the stuff as if it has no essential, necessary value. You may be thinking, well, how? Why? Why would he do that? Because here's what the manager came to understand. The manager came to understand all this money that I've been collecting, it don't belong to me anyway. It belongs to my master. And followers of Jesus can only serve one master. And so as Jesus is telling this parable, he's wanting his disciples to know when it comes to following him, you can only have one master. And the dangerous part is, if you're not careful, you'll allow money, possessions, and stuff to become your master, to become your God, and you won't even realize it until it's too late. And what we often forget is that this stuff that we call our own don't even belong to us. It's given to us by God. And that's how this shrewd saint of a manager get to the point of, like, you know what? This material stuff don't even really matter because it don't even belong to me. See, Jesus is encouraging his followers to use their money in the same way. Help others now. Provide for others now so that you will be taken care of later. You've heard at least one example of how you can do that today when Rachel stood up here and share with us about a food box. one that oftentimes we don't remind ourselves of is that every time you walk through these doors, you have an opportunity to put peanut butter. Peanut butter. It's simple. You go to the store at least once a week, I would imagine. Buy some extra peanut butter and bring it and drop it off at the church so that it can go to USAMAC so that people who are hungry can have something. You provide for others now so that you're taken care of later. Or maybe it's the reminder that God gave to his people in the book of Malachi when he talked about tithing. That you give me 10% and you see what I'll do when I open up the windows for you. The storehouses for you. Or maybe it's the proverb that reminds us from Proverbs 11:24, where it says, one gives freely, yet grows all the richer. Another withholds what he should give and only suffers want. One gives freely and grows all the richer. One withholds and suffers want. You think that don't make sense? Well, I'm here to tell you God's math does not make sense. But I'm also here to tell you that God is faithful, and if you do what God calls you to do, you will never go lacking, and you will probably be blown away by how God pours out blessing upon you. And so what Jesus is reminding his disciples is all the stuff you claim your own, it's not. It belongs to God. And as I thought about this dishonest manager, as this parable is called, the parable of the dishonest manager, I began to think, you know, the dishonesty was not really between human beings, as this parable is set up. The dishonesty was between human beings and the master. To take this idea and make it us, if we're not careful, we'll find ourselves robbing God because we're being dishonest with what God has given to us. We will find ourselves robbing God, not just because we don't put something in an offering plate, but maybe, just maybe, we don't put something in an offering plate, but we don't help the poor and needy like we should. Because I don't know if you've noticed, but there are poor and needy all the way around us. And Jesus says, the poor you will always have with you. And then he ends this parable by reminding his disciples. Because remember, he was talking specifically to his disciples and telling this parable. He ends this parable with reminding them, no one can serve two masters. You cannot serve God and wealth. And as we're wrapping up, if you read the King James Version, or were brought up on it like I was, the King James says you cannot serve both God and mammon. We don't understand that word mammon very much. But those who heard this word long, long, long ago, they understood what mammon is about. See, mammon is really the name of a false god the audience would know. It's the name of the false god for stuff, possessions, and wealth. And when Jesus says you cannot serve God and wealth or God and mammon, what Jesus is saying is you cannot have a divided loyalty. And if you're going to follow me, you can only serve one master. Which will you serve? See, a life of following Jesus, as I'm closing up, a life of following Jesus, this all-or-nothing mentality of following Jesus, it's one step of faithful attention after another. It's the frequent and the familiar task that you and I do each and every day. Or when Jesus said, you who are faithful in a little, you will be faithful with much. Another way to think about that is it's the nickels and dimes that turn into bigger accounts. And so how can you along the way pour into the accounts of others in their life? See, loving someone the way you love yourself is not looking into the plate to see how much they have. It's looking into their plate to make sure they have as much as you have or have enough. A life of following Jesus is giving and serving. As you heard me mention earlier, two of the most unnatural things to do are give and serve. They're also two of the biggest false gods, money and self. And so as we consider this idea of giving, let us not only think about giving financially, but how can you give of yourself through serving in the life of this church, through In His Steps? Have you been praying about where you'll sign up to serve? Because it takes every one of us working together for life to work in this church. And again, life consists of everydayness, everyday small opportunities. Here's what I've come to understand about my life and probably most of our lives. We will never achieve world peace. Many of us will never write a book. Most of us will never win a Nobel Prize. More than likely, we'll never end a war. But I know what we can do. We can give a cup of cold water to someone who's thirsty. We can write a note of love and encouragement to someone who's down. We can visit a shut-in or a nursing home. We can teach a Sunday school class or even go to a Sunday school class. We can give in the offering plate. We can help with youth or children. We can share a meal. We can help your neighbor. See, it's the everyday small things. Because when you're faithful in a very little, you'll also be faithful in much. And so as we consider following Jesus and giving it all up and thinking about this parable, it's the everyday small things of life that Jesus is calling our attention to. And how are we living out loving our neighbor as ourself? And what are we allowing to define us? Is it stuff, money, possessions, or is it Jesus? Because at the end of the day, when it's all said and done, followers of Jesus can only serve one master. So the question for you, the question for me this morning, what is your master? What are you allowing to lead your life? Let us pray. Lord God, we pray. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you would work in our minds, work in our hearts, that you would bring about some conviction and some honesty in ourselves as we ask this question, what is my master? What am I allowing to lead my life? And God, if we can't say with full out conviction and honesty that it's Jesus, then Lord, help us. Because we're serving not you, but some other master and some other God. And you are the only living God. Jesus, I pray today that as we close out with this song, draw us closer to you. Help us to put aside the things that hinder, put aside the things that draw attention away from following you. In Christ's holy name we do pray. Amen.
And this last song of worship that we're going to do is it's not a familiar song. We've done it one time before. It's called Living in the Overflow, but it's a perfect song to end this worship service with because it's talking about living in the overflow, whether that be in the overflow of financially or living in the overflow of the grace and the mercy and the love that God gives us. We are all living in that overflow. So I'm going to ask that we stand together. And that we try to sing this song together is pretty catchy. You can catch on pretty quickly on it. We ask that you sing this because it's a great song of praise to praise God for allowing us to live in that overflow each and every day. So let's sing together.
Overflow. let your kingdom come. Forever we reign, living in the overflow. The bound are now set free, everywhere we go we see the victory. Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
And we are living in the overflow. Such an abundance of God's grace and God's Spirit upon our lives. Let us go out from this place, providing love and life and hope for all we come into contact with, through God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let's join hands together.